Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Oops. Praise God for the rain last night. Hope he didn't drop any trees on your house. We're going to start our song service with "As the Deer Panteth for the Water." Next one will be, "You Are My All in All."
Thank you.
Let's now stand for our opening song, number 108, Amazing Grace.
This morning, we are delighted to welcome each and every one of you to our beautiful Kansas City Central Seventh-day Adventist Church. We really are proud of our church, and I know you will be blessed as we worship our saving Jesus today. As far as the announcement goes, I think you're all literate, you can read. I don't have to go through all of this thing, but there are a couple of things I need to say. You know, Mary Jenk, last week we had the first reading. She's transferring from Kansas City Central to Chapel Oaks, and today we are going to vote whether you approve of that or not. If anyone who wants to approve, first, okay, all who say yes, now, carry on. I have somebody who came and start sitting here. I'm sure Jerry will have something to say, so I'll give her a time.
Okay, howdy, buckaroos. So tomorrow is VBS go time. Please bring your kids at 5:45. Registration, get them settled. Thank you everyone for all your help and your prayers for Vacation Bible School. Here we go, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, 6 p.m. to 8:30. Thank you, thank you.
Okay, Mike just came and also notified me. ASI has a small video clip he would like to see, to show, before we give time for children's story time to Maurice.
ASI is a convention of like-minded people that are movers and shakers. They're people that don't just want to sit on the sidelines. They want to get involved. They want to come. They want to spark an interest. They're people that have an entrepreneurial mindset. They're looking for the next thing. They're looking for a next opportunity, a niche, something that they can get in, make an impact, start a fire somewhere per se, get people excited about ministry and ultimately sharing Jesus in the workplace.
I think for me, the biggest observation was seeing people bringing their ministry and telling others about Christ into their career and into their work sphere. A lot of times you like to separate them, but it's good to see people who are merging them and doing it in a very effective way.
ASI is a wonderful opportunity to get to know new people and also network with people, but beyond that, it's a great way to be able to find ministries that you can be part of that can support your journey with Jesus, also to be able to help you to be able to help others to learn more about Jesus.
There's so many brilliant minds here as Adventists that I can just talk to and just see their perspective on how to approach, you know, specific situations and, you know, just how their ministry was coming up from the ground up and basically learning that as I seek to do ministry as well.
You know, we've always loved ASI. You come here and you gather warmth from the warmth of others. It gives you a chance to collaborate or to discover new ways of collaborating. You know, when we come to ASI as a ministry, it is written, feels very much like we're here walking with ASI, walking with ASI members. We're all in this thing together. Jesus called us all to share Jesus with the world. So, you know, you come to ASI and you realize that ministry engaged by the church and church entities is this great big thing. To be a part of that and to be a part of that with other ministries that are seeking to be used by God to really impact this world, that's a powerful thing from a ministry perspective.
When you are working in your places, you kind of sometimes feel you're alone until you can come to events like this and you realize you're not alone in the work. You realize that sometimes you're tunnel vision and you don't see what God is doing, but you come to places like this and you see He's doing miraculous things that you could probably never fathom. So to me, ASI is important for that.
ASI has been a tremendous blessing to me, and I think what it's done is that it's given me a personal desire to share my faith with others, and it also has encouraged me as a ministry leader.
There's nothing like ASI to be able to learn how to do your ministry better, or to be able to gather resources, ideas, or seminars in how you can be more effective, or talk to people that have had similar experience. There's nothing like ASI.
Just to go somewhere and people are genuinely interested in what you're doing, giving you that encouragement to keep going, I mean, it's a blessing every year, both to give and also to receive. So the whole experience is fantastic.
I would say that ASI is extremely inspiring, and if you've never been, I would highly recommend you go, because it will just be life-changing.
I would say, like, there's no place like this place, anywhere near this place, so this must be the place.
I think they're having their convention in maybe 2-3 weeks in August. So if anybody wants to go, this is for you. Now, it's children's story time.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everybody. Got to bring this down. We have an awesome God, isn't that right? Now, tell me, I'm going to have you help tell the story today. Tell me who created, if you children want to come up here, you can. Tell me who created the world. Who created the world? God did. Thank you, Isaiah. I'm glad you can speak up better than these adults. Thank you. All right. Adults, you need to speak up. So God created the world, right? And we read that in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now, we have been reading through our Bible, and it kind of been slacking a little bit the last few weeks. But I was reading in Amos, and you know it says almost the same thing? Listen to what it says in Amos chapter 4, verse 13. For lo, he that formed the mountains and created the wind and declared unto man what is in the thought, that maketh the morning darkness and treadeth upon the high places of the earth, who is that? God. And that's exactly what it says. The Lord, the God of hosts, is his name. Now, Genesis said, God created. Amos says, God created. And you know what? In Revelation, it says that God created. All through the Bible, it talks about God creating. Now, he created everything, right? Yeah. Did he create you? Oh, yeah. Seriously? Huh. So if God created you, does he love you?
Yes.
Yes. How much? Show me with your arms. How much does God love you? Oh, as big and as far as you can stretch, right? Does he love you always? Even if you misbehave? Really? Yeah. And adults, don't forget that. Even when you mess up, even if you make a mistake, God still loves you. What does God want for you? He wants us to be good. Is God preparing a place for us?
Yeah.
How do you know?
Because in the Bible it says that he's waiting until we go to, and he's creating a palace.
God is creating a palace. In the Bible it says mansion. So let me read. Let's go to John chapter 14. Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, Jesus is speaking here, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. You, every one of us, everyone. God is preparing a place for you. And Jesus is still speaking. He says, and, so when somebody says, and, what does that mean? Something else is going to happen?
Yeah.
And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. So, where did Jesus go? He went to heaven. And that's where he's preparing a place for us, right? And so he says, I will come again, right? And receive you unto myself. In other words, I'm going to grab a hold of you and hug you. And that where I am, there ye may be also. So he's going to take us, where?
To heaven,
where he's preparing a place for us. Can you wait?
Yep.
Are you sure? Would you rather Jesus come today? Not quite today? When do you want Jesus to come?
When I die.
Oh, I don't want to wait that long. I want Jesus to come soon. I am ready for Jesus to come. I am tired of all the bad things that are happening in this world. Like last night, there was a terrible storm. People were injured. Homes were injured. Trees were blown down. It was pretty ugly last night. I'm tired of that ugliness, aren't you? Yeah, I'm tired of it. So let's ask Jesus to come soon and take us to that mansion that he's preparing for us, where we'll never die, where we won't ever get sick, Isaiah, where we won't ever get hurt, and we'll always be with Jesus and those who love Jesus with our family members. And who's our family members? Do you have family members sitting here? Yeah, we're all your church family. So when we get to heaven, I'm going to look for you, Isaiah. I'm going to look for you, Nova. I'm going to look for you. I'm going to look for you. I'm going to look for everybody, because I want everybody to be here in heaven, don't you? Yeah. All right, so let's ask Jesus. Let's talk to Jesus. Let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us so much to come to this earth as a little baby, to grow up, to die on the cross for us, for our sins, for our mistakes, for our horribleness, to give us new life because you rose from the grave and gave us that promise that if we believe in you, that you will save us from this world of sin, from this life of sin, and that you will have prepared a place for us so that we can live with you forever and be happy forever. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me.
Our loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless each one of us here this morning, and we thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship our awesome God. We're looking for the day very soon to see Jesus coming in the clouds of heaven, and to that end, we pray to bless this congregation and each one of us here. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Yeah, it's time for our offering. I was looking at what we have done so far. It looks like we're going to make it because the budget is $4,168.32. Month to date, we have $3,460. And we have how many more Sabbaths? I think today and next week. This month has five Sabbaths, so we're going to make it, and we thank you so much for helping the cause of God. Will the deacon stand up? Father, We thank you so much for blessing us with the wealth that you have entrusted to us. We thank you so much for giving us health to work and make money and also return tithes and offering. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now time for intercessory prayer. In as much as it is physically possible for you to do so, we like to kneel. Father, we kneel before the throne of your grace, thanking you for what you have done for us by giving us eternal life through the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We thank you for our church, for the members. We thank you for our unions, conferences, and all the leaders in this church, preparing us to meet the Lord. Father, there are people who are unable to attend the church because of health reason. We pray that you, the greatest physician, may extend your healing hands to them so that they may be here next week. Father, there are many things going on around the world. There are troubles, there are diseases, pestilences, difficulties, both for the people of God. We pray that you take care of your people. We know it's your will to do so, and we are grateful. We thank you for the elders in the church. We thank you for the deacons and everyone serving your church at Kansas City Central Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're just blessed and lucky to be here. In Christ's name we pray. We pray that you also may speak to our speaker. Help him to bring to us what comes from your throne, and help each one of us to listen attentively. And also, may we be transformed by what comes from that throne above. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Reaching out with no one to hold, you've been abandoned with no place to go, wounded and wanting such desperate times, cold bitter tears are filling your eyes. Get a glimpse of Jesus, for he is right there with you. He knows just what you need. But the storm raged and raged. Now it's hard to imagine how you'll make it through the day. Weeks turns to years, time's passing you by, but you're still holding on to the house and the wise. So get a glimpse of Jesus, for he is right there with you. He knows just what you.
We thank the young lady who was doing it. The scripture reading for today is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 22, verse 11 and 12. He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give to everyone according to his work. May the Lord bless the reading.
Good morning, everybody. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. How many of you feel that it's so good to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Just give me a few minutes. Let me get myself together. I want to express my gratitude to every one of you for your cards, those that visited, and more importantly, for your earnest prayers on my behalf when I had surgery. I'm not saying that you should not relent your prayers. I still need those prayers. Please continue your prayers on my behalf and we have to pray for one another. Thank you so very much. Today is a continuation of what we started probably 2 months or more ago before I had my surgery. It is called the Great Wrestling Match. And I'll run you through, for those that are wearing here, I'll just run you through some highlights of what we discussed, right? We talked about, I was able to show you, I don't want to go back to that, pictures of wrestlers when we were young in the 70s and the 80s. You know, I talked of someone like Me Mascaras, you know, the Dino Brothers. If you love wrestling, then you remember Mighty Eagle, so forth and so on. So I was able to bring those pictures, and we saw that they had fun. It wasn't the type of wrestling that we are seeing today, but it was more or less entertaining. They were entertaining everybody. Then we moved on to talk about our subject of that day, and that was Jacob. That was Jacob. We saw that in his uncle's house, where he was, there was envy and there was jealousy because God has so much blessed him. So Laban's children were envious of their in-law and their cousin, let me put it that way. So they started some problem. Then Laban also came. He wasn't speaking favorably to his nephew. Then God spoke to Jacob and said, hey, man, it's time to go back to your country. You're from somewhere. You got to go back. So when Laban was somewhere, he decided to move with his family. When Laban came back, he wasn't happy. So he decided to pursue after him. But God warned Laban, do not say anything to this young man, right or wrong. Don't say anything to him. Leave him alone, for I am with him. Then when he crossed that hurdle, then he was also faced with the hurdle of meeting his brother, Esau. So he tried everything within human understanding and calculation, how he was going to appease his brother. He sent gifts and he sent emissary to his brother. Look, I'm coming home. So these are the gifts for you. But when they got there, they saw that his brother was also coming to meet with him. And he had 400 men fully armed. So Jacob was disturbed. He was discouraged. So he had to have an emergency plan. Emergency preparedness. Now he had to separate his families. So that is where we are going to start today. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I am weak, but you are strong. Father, humble me and empty me of self, that the word that will come out from me, O Lord, will be what you ask me to tell your congregation. For I pray, Lord, and I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So what Jacob did at this point was I said he separated his family. Then at a point he was left alone. He removed all distractions. Everything that would distract him, he removed it from himself. We are on Genesis 32. Genesis 32, if you want to follow along, but if not, we are on Genesis 32. He was left alone, and he thought, what else could I do? I have just one source of energy. I have one source of power. And that source is the divine help. So Jacob decided that he was going to... Is that in... Oh, okay, Rex, you coming to my aid? All right, thank you. You also have someone who knows more than I do. Okay, while he's doing, trying to... So he decided that this is all I'm going to do. I am going to the one who told me that it is time to go back home. You gave me the promise that, look, I am with you. I'm going to be with you. So he decided it is time. No more distraction. So he was there in the dark all night. Fighting with the Lord in prayer, confessing his sins, thinking that, how will I be the end of these innocent people? How am I going to be their end? What is going to happen with all these women, all these young kids? While he was doing this, while he was praying and struggling with the Lord, all of a sudden, in the dark, a hand reached out to him. Let me ask you, what will you do if in the midst of your crisis, in the midst of your trouble, you knew quite well that you have an adversary coming after your life, and that you decided it is time for me to seek the face of the Lord in prayer? I want to be by myself alone. Then all of a sudden, somebody grabbed you. What will you do? I'm seeing some of you, thank you, some of you jumping up, screaming, right? I know that's what somebody would do. Jump up and scream. Jacob was a human being, so he said, no, I'm not going to go down alone. I'm not going to go down alone. It's a fight for my existence. So he thought, this is just my own thought, that this could be his brother coming to eliminate him, coming to take his life. Then the wrestling began. I don't know what type of wrestling it was, but there was this struggle. He was fighting for his life, and he was also at the same time confessing his sins to God. That, God, I know I've done all this. I've offended my brother. I stole from him. I cheated. He started confessing all his faults before the Lord, while at the same time, this wrestling match was going on. He was not going to let this man throw him down, because he knows that if he's down, that might be his end. So he said, no, you are not going to throw me down. They were struggling and struggling until daybreak. When it was daybreak, the adversary said, oh, hold on. It's daybreak, let me go. It was at this point that Jacob realized that I must have been fighting with the angel of God, with God himself. I must have been fighting with God himself. He said, no, you are not, I'm not going to let you go. No, you are not going. You are not going. I will not let you go until you bless me. Why not? We've been struggling all night, fighting all night. You refuse to reveal yourself. Now that I have known that I am wrestling with God and you have spared my life, you are not going to go until you bless me. Remember, he has been blessed by his father, but now he wants the original blessing that comes only from God. Look, there's so much human being can do for you, but the main blessing comes only from God. Like I said, this is a quote from Patriarchs and Prophets. Bitterness of all was the thought that it was his own sin which had brought this spirit upon the innocent. With earnest cries and tears, he made his prayer before God. Suddenly, a strong hand was laid upon him. He thought an enemy was seeking his life and endeavored to wrest himself from the grasp of his assailant. In the darkness, the two struggled for mastery. This is just going back to what I said earlier on. Jacob depended, he leaned on the everlasting arm. He leaned on the arm that cannot fail him, because there was this promise already. Go, I will be with you. In his prayer, he reminded God that, look, you made this promise to me. You told me to go. Why are you going to disappoint me at this time? It was a struggle. Let us come back to ourselves. Let us come back home. Let us come back home. In your time of distress, in your time of trouble, when you are left all alone, all by yourself, who do you turn to? Do you lean on human hands, or do you lean on the divine hands? You see, for us as human beings, when we are in our lowest point, sometimes we forget about God. We forget that there is one who can help me carry and fight this battle. We try everything within our possible, within our human effort, to solve divine problems. But most often we fail, because we have failed to recognize that there is an omnipotent hand that can help us in the time of trouble, and that we can lean on this hand. When we put our trust in God, he will see us through our darkest period. I don't know if you can read, but I think I can read from here. What exactly are we talking about? A time of trouble is coming. For us as Adventists, we know that there is a time of trouble. A time we call time of Jacob's trouble. What are we talking about again? It will be a time when Christ leaves his ministry in heaven. When he says, it is done, let him who is filthy be filthy, and let him who is righteous be righteous. There will be no intercessor. It is that faith that you have, that you have been developing in Christ every day, that will carry the Christians through. And that is why we keep saying that the faith that will live in time of trouble must be daily in exercise now. We have to learn to lean on that everlasting arm on a daily basis. Hour by hour, we should rely on that arm that is not going to fail us. I'm going to read through this. Jacob's experience during the night of wrestling and anguish represents the trial through which the people of God must pass just before Christ's second coming. The prophet Jeremiah, in his solely vision, looking down to this time, said, "We have heard a voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace. All faces are turned into paleness. Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it." There is this promise that I keep repeating. Lo, I am with you always. Even to the very end, Christ will not forsake his own. He is not going to forsake you no matter what happens. But we must recognize who we have. If you fail to recognize him, it is not about coming to church. It is not about what I'm doing now. It is not about being a Sabbath superintendent or playing church. It is about a personal commitment to Christ now. The time is very short. The time is very short. We do not know when it will be, when he will stop his ministration on behalf of man. And after that, what happens? We expect that there will be the seven plagues that will be poured out on the earth. The wicked, let me use the word the wicked, will accuse the faithful that they are the cause of their problems, that they are the cause of the hardship that has befallen man, and they will seek them to destroy them. But the faithful, we have no place to run to, but to run to the everlasting arm. It is going to happen, if it's not in our own time, in our lifetime, but it is surely going to happen. Like I said, do not be afraid. There is no cause for alarm. There is no cause for fear, because we know whom we have believed in. Do you know who you believe in? Do you know the power that is in Christ? The lesson we learned this morning says that all authority in heaven and on earth are given into his hand. He was with Jacob during his time of trouble, during his time of trial, and he will not abandon us, even in our own present day times of trouble. There's a question I want to ask. I say a few more minutes. There's a question I want to ask you this morning. What was the fight about between Esau and Jacob? What was it all about? Was it about inheritance? Was it about birthright? That's what many of us would think. It is about birthright. But let me ask you this question. Where did Christ come from? Esau or Jacob? The line of Jacob. That was what it is all about. The devil has interest in destroying that line where God has made a promise. There was a promise right from the Garden of Eden about the promised seed. Don't forget that, the promised seed. And if Esau was able to destroy Jacob, that would have set the time back, which was impossible because God has already set his time. But one good thing again is this. When Jacob was wrestling with the angel, God sent another angel to Esau. Go and talk to him that this man, Jacob, is special. His sins are forgiven. You cannot touch him.
In the dream, the angel warned Esau, "This is mine. Leave him alone." Along the line, when Jacob was successful, when he overcame, he had a peace in his mind. Now he was able to gather his family together. He was able to gather his children. And Jacob, who was running, who was afraid, now decided it is time to go and meet my brother Esau. You'll find that in Genesis 34. He had that confidence. What gave him that confidence? The peace that comes from God. The peace that he had been forgiven. The peace that God has accepted his plea. And that God has changed his name from being a deceiver to an overcomer. So he knew that there is somebody behind him. He said, it's time. Let us go meet Esau. Esau with his 400 armed men were also coming. But when Esau saw his brother limping, when he saw that he was limping, in his mind, how can I fight a man who is already weak? There is no point. This man is already weak. But God impressed upon his mind, and he had a love for his brother. And he ran, he met his brother, and there was an embrace. There was crying. It was more than 20 years he had seen his brother last. Irrespective of what the devil was playing, but he still was his brother. What are we trying to learn today? That relying on man's help is vain. You remember, Jacob tried everything within his power. He tried to send emissaries. He tried to send gifts just to appease his brother. That is all he knew. But that did not solve his problem. Remember that human effort will always fail us, but divine will not. And I want to read this again, probably before we close. In his night of anguish beside the Jabbok, when destruction seemed just before him, Jacob had been taught how vain is the help of man, how groundless is all trust in human power. He saw that his only help must come from him against whom he has so grievously sinned. Helpless and unworthy, he pleaded God's promise of mercy to the repentant sinner. The promise was his assurance that God would not pardon, that God would pardon and accept him. Sooner might heaven and earth pass than that word could fail. And it was this that sustained him through that fearful conflict. The promise that God will not fail. And to recap, there is always a call for repentance. Look, it doesn't matter how many times we come to church, we need to rely on that everlasting arm. If Jacob did not repent, did not confess of his sin, he would have perished. The children might have been spared, because the promised Messiah will come from his offspring. But he could have perished in that, because how can you wrestle with God with a sinful heart? But he was sorry for his sin. He knew that he had wronged his brother. He confessed. In the time of trouble, if the people of God abhor on confessed sins, they will be overwhelmed and their faith will fail. Those who have not confessed and repented will be overwhelmed by the evil one. That one is sure. You see, finally, like I said, the blessing he craved for
that he tried to obtain by trade could only be given by divine grace and divine power alone, and that he received at last, which was original. We cannot underemphasize the importance of prayer, especially in this day and age. We need to wrestle with God in prayer alone, without distraction. When you are overwhelmed, when there are troubles all around you, do not forget that we have an everlasting arm to lean on. He will not fail us. He did not fail Jacob. He is not going to fail you. He is not going to fail me. Let us lean on that arm as times are getting more difficult. He will smooth the way for us. He will lead us all through. We'll stop here until we end. The next one will be the part 3. We have something. Got it. Just a minute.
When the storms of life are raging, stand by me,
stand by me.
When the storms of life are raging, stand by me,
stand by me.
When the like a ship out on the sea, thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me,
stand by me.
When I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me. When I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me,
stand by me.
When I do the best I can, and my friends misunderstand, thou who never lost a battle, stand by me,
stand by me.
Thou who never lost a battle, stand by me,
stand.
Stand for our closing song, number 99, God Will Take Care of You.
God will take care of you.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask, O Lord, that may you take care of your children. When they are in need, when they are sick, when they are in trouble, please, Father, teach us, O Lord, to lean on that everlasting arm that will not fail us. For we pray, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.